So thank you, Ankur. And I think these are the most recently formed guidelines. Usually, guidelines take years to develop and then they are again refurbished. And this is COVID for last 3 months. So I think these are the shortest trending guidelines as of today. That's why it's a work on evolution and they are continuously changing. So I've tried to consolidate the three big guideline sources: American Society of Clinical Oncology, European Society of Medical Oncology, and National Cancer Care Network, who has consortium of all these centers to frame the guidelines. I still think that these guidelines are not complete and they will be refreshed every now and then so as to give a full picture. Moving to the next slide. So just before we start, I think something which is being on the rounds on the WhatsApp University of COVID-19 is that less than 1 gram of virus has made the world go to a standstill. And I think if we think from the cancer point of view, DNA also is less than 1 gram as far as a human is concerned. If it is not treated well, it can also make a person ill. So there is a direct comparison. Obviously, it's not an infective disease, cancer, and that's why not much resources of government are always directed. So it's some basic statements. We have to always decide what we are going to treat is going to be an emergency or it can take a non-emergency way. Reason being, the purpose of all these guidelines is basically to decrease the patient's visit to the hospital, which is a beneficial mutual way both the patient, for the patient as well as the doctor. It decreases the patient exposure to any COVID-19 virus as well as it decreases the exposure of the healthcare worker also to the same thing. So it's a basically win-win situation to the both sides. Moreover, it frees the hospital resources for better care of the patients, unfortunate patients who have been struck with the COVID-19 and really serious. That's why these guidelines have come up so as to help us guide how to improve the cancer treatment outcome without compromising the outcome. So interestingly, till 1 month back, all those patients who were diagnosed recently with cancer or who were still eligible for any sort of cancer treatment, except those who were on the best supportive care, on a home-based care, when the family had already, patient had already had progression on multiple lines. All those patients were repeatedly called to the hospital for clinical assessment for the enrollment in the trials, for disease assessment, for the counseling part, everything. And all of a sudden, within last 1 month, everything has changed. Only those patients who have been recently diagnosed, newly diagnosed, or those who have symptoms, very symptomatic disease, they are the persons who require emergency care. So the surgical part has partly been discussed by my surgical colleagues, but to reiterate, patients in GI cancers, those who have obstruction, those who have intestinal obstruction, or those who have a biliary tract obstruction are the real emergencies who will require continuous treatment and monitoring. So these are the patients who should be admitted to the hospital. Now there is a debate which is always on whether to do for COVID testing, yes or no, but that all depends on the government guidelines and the institutional guidelines. As an oncologist, I would say if the patient has presented with these emergencies, patient has full right to get admitted to get treated. Coming to the adjuvant versus palliative part, adjuvant treatment should not be discontinued or delayed because we are dealing with the definitive treatment, the curative part. However, the palliative care part can be dealt telephonically with the teleconsult with the help of a palliative care physicians. Whenever you are deciding the treatment of a patient, always consider what is the quantum of benefit. Whenever the quantum of benefit weighs above the quantum of the risk to the patient, you ask the patient to come to the hospital. Is there any alternative available? Because like in lockdown, patients did not have access to the centers. They were taking their treatments. We encountered many such patients because we catered to whole of the Uttar Pradesh, Punjab, Haryana, Rajasthan, and to some extent to Madhya Pradesh. So since oncology is a small world, we tried to patch up with the local oncologists, local physicians, gastroenterologists over there so that they can be the part of care and continuum of care so that the patient doesn't suffer. When we are going to start with the treatment, it's better to delay if we assess the disease biology as a slow. However, once we have started, we should not stop the treatment because if that happens, the disease becomes resistance. And also we have to take into consideration the tolerance of the patient and no doubt last but not the least, which is the most important these days, whether the patient has comorbidities in the form of diabetes, hypertension or cardiac patients. We all have learned that from the experience from China, US and Italy, all those oncology patients who were aged more than 70 years had either one or a combination of these three comorbidities, whether diabetes, hypertension, or for that matter, any chronic condition requiring a chronic treatment, they had the maximum mortality. So the death, whether it was due to COVID-19 or because of COVID-19 in view of the cancer as well as the comorbidities, is a question which has yet not been answered. But to be on the cautious side, any patient who is more than 70 years of age on a treatment which is myelosuppressive and has comorbidities, we should be very judiciously giving some conservative treatment and not very aggressive treatment to such patients. Next, please. Ankit, next slide. So there is time to change our practice. Like, we were usually giving maintenance therapy to all those patients whom we suspected or which were feared of that the disease is going to come back early. So maintenance therapy was routinely given. So time to stop, introspect and think and stop these maintenance therapies, because maintenance was to improve the progression-free survival, not the overall survival. So time to stop this maintenance treatment, because the risk of the COVID-19 infection leading to mortality and death is much higher than the minuscule benefit of PFS these maintenance therapies are going to give. Most importantly, it's time to switch to oral therapies. However, the compliance and toxicity monitoring can be done through the teleconsultation way. I think the gastroenterology and GI surgery colleagues will be thinking that how to go for the teleconsultation. There are lots of seminars, webinars being done online these months after the 25th March, when the MCI legalized sort of the telemedicine part with the detailed guidelines. Everyone has got a right now to do a teleconsultation, which before 25th March was considered as a crime, because you were bound by the Consumer Protection Act. You were not getting a single penny paid, but you had all the responsibility. Now with the MCI coming for our rescue, telemedicine we can resort to maintain and observe the patients on oral therapies. Third point will be prophylactic growth factors. Usually we used to give growth factors to all those patients who had myelosuppressive potential of more than 10 to 15%. However, nowadays, since we don't want to increase the hospital visit to the patients for the blood sampling, for the meet with the clinician to find out how they have tolerated, how is the mucositis, we have routinely incorporated in our practice to abundantly use the growth factors so as to decrease the hospital visits and improve the tolerance to the treatment. Lowering the doses of chemotherapy is being concerned only in the metastatic or palliative settings, to decrease the toxicity and thus the risk of the complications if what forbid patient gets a COVID-19 infections. Immunotherapy, I think a lot of data will be there in about 1 to 2 year time, but as of today, there are no recommendations or indications to either increase the duration of the immunotherapies or to decrease the duration of the immunotherapies. Next. So on the basis of these, ESMO has categorized the patients into three categories: high priority, medium priority, low priority. High priority will, as we have discussed, are the patients we cannot leave, whether they are at the start of the diagnosis or in between the treatment, they are all high priority. Medium priority patient is not critical, treatment can be delayed beyond 6 weeks, but I think this medium priority would have sufficed if we were at the mid of the March. Now, having the April ending, we are already 6 weeks down, and all those patients which would have stopped treatment or deferred treatment in mid-March, they will be eligible for treatment. And I think the medium priority now also shifts to the high priority. So all patients who are newly diagnosed or in the middle of the treatment have to be continuing the treatment as per the established guidelines. Low priority are the patients who are only 2-monthly, 3-monthly follow-up, or the check endoscopies, colonoscopies, blood testing. These are the patients who can be best dealt with the teleconsultations. And a word about the scopies. I think there has been much evidence now that all invasive procedures or all scopy procedures, including endoscopies, colonoscopies, and bronchoscopies, especially the endoscopy and bronchoscopy, the performer is much at a risk of having the COVID infection. Though some data says PP has got a full protection, but we know that despite a 100% PP, the protection is not complete 100%. So I think we need to prioritize the scopies also only for the diagnosis, when we have a new patient to diagnose, or we have an obstruction in the colonoscopy of the obstruction, we have to document the obstruction or if there is a need for stenting. Otherwise, the check endoscopies, which we used to do for the follow-up patients, can take a backseat, can wait for 2 to 3 months before actually the pandemic settles down and we are able to move on to these patients. Next. So OP visits, we have discussed newly diagnosed patients, symptomatic patients. They are the patients who should come to the OPD, and we should promote these patients coming to the OPD rather than only giving the teleconsultations. Medium risk patients are asymptomatic, who are newly diagnosed and exposed, who have been operated. Like the two patients earlier, we discussed Dr. Sanjeev and Dr. Asif. Now, they were in the midst of treatment. They had had surgery done. One is post-operative day 4. Now, these are the patients in which we have to start adjuvant therapy, and we know delaying the adjuvant therapy to 6 to 12 weeks does not significantly change the outcome. So, provided they have a smooth recovery, we should aim not for the 3 to 4 weeks, which is our usual target. We should aim for 4 to 6 weeks so that the patient's recovery is also better, their compliance to the treatment is better, and their risk for the COVID-19 goes down if we are able to contain the pandemic. And all those patients who require a restaging are the patients who should be teleconsulted only, should not be asked to come to the hospitals for any sort of investigation. They can do the investigation near their native place and consult you telephonically or any other electronic medium. Next. I think this we have discussed. So there are 3 types of patients from medical oncology: patients requiring neoadjuvant therapy, patients requiring adjuvant therapy, and patient requiring palliative therapy. So neoadjuvant therapy will be obviously in the patients who are in the high priority. Suppose a newly diagnosed CA esophagus who is in near going who is going to be completely obstructed, only able to take liquids, or a patient with the colon cancer or rectal cancer who is bleeding profusely or is going to or into the impending obstructions. These are the patients who need to be started with the neoadjuvant treatment, and whatever is the advisable treatment in the form of neoadjuvant chemo radiation, only chemotherapy, that should be given. However, whenever there is a choice of using one modality rather than two modalities, and if the it has been proven in the past that the outcomes are the same, to prefer one modality. The simple example is CA esophagus. Suppose it is a squamous cell carcinoma of the esophagus and you plan to give a chemo radiation. Radiation, we know that has some scatter effect on the lungs. And with the COVID-19 also, you have majority of the patients having chest complications. In such patients, with a mutual discussion with the patient explaining the risk, you can shift to only single agent chemotherapy first, because that is one of the proven modalities which has shown equal results in a neoadjuvant chemo radiation. However, in the rectum or the colon, the priorities may change. In the rectum also, there is a change in the strategy which at max we are doing. So all such patients who are coming with the CA rectum in requirement of the neoadjuvant chemo radiation, we have adopted short course radiation in such patients, which lasts only 2 weeks and only a single modality. Some people do try and give capecitabine, but the short course radiotherapy that lasts only about 2 weeks gives very good results as far as pathological control of the disease is concerned. And we, after a cooling off period of 1 to 2 weeks, that is after 1 month, we can operate upon such patients and then do the adjuvant treatment, whatever is required. And also in the adjuvant treatment part of it, so the standard of care has been FOLFOX, which we all know is an intravenous chemotherapy for all colorectal patients in the adjuvant setting. In the past, capecitabine with oxaliplatin has been compared with the intravenous chemotherapies, and both have been found to be equal. So nowadays we have shifted our plan of treatment in the adjuvant setting from the FOLFOX, which is a 2-weekly regimen, to 3-weekly regimen. So I would say, to sum up, in majority of the patients we have changed our protocol, requiring least hospitalizations, less hospital visits, and most of the oral treatment. Ankit, next. Next, Ankit, this we have already discussed. So we are trying to decrease the hospital visits. We are increasing the use of the growth factors. We have decreased the duration of chemotherapies wherever the trial-like idea allow us to do so. And as Ankur mentioned, we are trying to incorporate in the neoadjuvant setting some chemotherapies for some reason patient is not able to undergo surgery. Next. I think this with this I will conclude that medical oncology wise, we are maintaining the intent of the treatment, but with the different sort of combinations. thanks, Ankur, back to you.